Thank you. This evening I'm going to talk to you about how the human brain controls movement, what happens when things go wrong, and some new research that aims to identify movement disorders earlier than is currently possible. Now, most of the movements that we perform every day happen without us having to think too much about it. Now, this implies that movement might be a simple brain function, but actually it's not. It's incredibly complicated. Now, if we take this example here, the ability to grip and lift an object requires a grip force that's sufficient to overcome the effects of gravity on the object, pulling in this direction, but it also needs to prevent the object slipping. Now, the grip force also needs to be sufficient that it doesn't damage the object or cause unnecessary muscle fatigue. Now, the amount of grip force required to lift an unfamiliar object is already predetermined by the brain in advance. And the brain predetermines how much grip force is required based on the physical properties of the object, such as the size and the shape. It also makes its prediction based on our prior experience and also the individual's safety margin to prevent the object slipping from the grasp. The brain also predicts in advance what's going to happen during each phase of the movement, and it does all this without us really knowing about it and in the space of a few hundred milliseconds, so it happens very quickly. Now, the control of movement involves much of the human brain. A movement requires an awareness of where the body is in relation to where it intends to go, and also selection of the appropriate plan to get there. Once a plan has been selected, it needs to be held in memory and then implemented at the appropriate time. Now, a region of the brain called the motor cortex is particularly important for movement. The motor cortex is the region of the brain that sends messages down to the muscle, causing the muscle to contract and move the limb. Now, messages that travel down from the motor cortex to the muscle can be modified by receptors that are located in the muscle itself, and also by activity in other brain regions that are involved in the initiation, speed, and coordination of movement. Now, studying how the human brain controls movement is not easy, because people actually need to be conscious to perform voluntary movements. This means that scientists need to rely on mainly non-invasive techniques to study how the human brain controls movement. One technique that we can use is called magnetic resonance imaging, or MRI. Now, this technique involves the patient or volunteer lying on this bed, and then the bed is inserted inside the scanner. The technique is very safe, and it actually produces pictures of the brain that have quite a high image resolution, such as this one here. Now, taking still pictures of the brain is really helpful in many clinical settings, but it doesn't actually tell us how the brain controls movement in terms of which parts of the brain are activated during movement and how they work together to execute the movements that we want to perform. However, recent advances in magnetic resonance imaging have allowed us to gain more insight into how the brain actually performs movement. So scientists can use a technique called functional magnetic resonance imaging, or fMRI, to study how the brain actually performs movements. And this technique involves actually getting a volunteer to perform a movement while they're inside the scanner. We then look for changes in blood flow in the brain. This is an example over here of a volunteer that performed a movement inside the scanner. And the parts of the brain that experienced an increase in blood flow during the movement are shown in yellow, orange, and red. Now, this increase in blood flow tells us that these brain regions were actually contributing to the person performing the movement and are actually an integral part of the way that we move in daily life. Now, we can also use functional magnetic resonance imaging to study the tracks or highways that go between brain regions that are involved in movement. This is an example here of the highway that goes between the motor cortex and the spinal cord. Now, we can also use functional magnetic resonance imaging to study chemicals in the brain. Neurons or brain cells communicate with one another by release of chemical signals. And scientists can actually investigate these chemical signals in particular parts of the brain. Now, the specialised brain chemicals are called neurotransmitters, and scientists can actually select the part of the brain that they're interested in, such as this section here, and actually measure the chemical spectrum of that particular brain region. So in a sense, we can measure the levels of these chemical messengers that are in particular parts of the brain that we're interested in. Now, so far I've talked about how we can take fancy pictures of the brain, but now I'm going to talk to you about a technique that we can use to momentarily take control of a conscious person's brain to study movement. And the technique that we use is called transcranial magnetic brain stimulation. Now, this technique, what it allows us to do is to actually activate the motor cortex instead of the volunteer doing it themselves. And we can actually create, as scientists, we can create a movement in a conscious volunteer. And the technique is incredibly safe, it's non-invasive, and it doesn't hurt, which is quite a benefit when you're trying to study how the human brain controls movement. And the technique is particularly useful for telling us about the pathway that goes between the motor cortex and the muscle. So remembering that this is the region of the brain that actually sends messages down to the muscle, causing us to move. Now, I've brought one of these stimulators along today to give you a demonstration of the technique. So what I'd like to do is to stimulate my brain, and we're going to make a movement using the brain stimulator. And what I'd like to do is to ask two people from the audience to come up and help me. So one volunteer is actually going to hold the coil on top of my head, and the other volunteer, or the other audience member, is going to actually press the button to stimulate my brain. So can I ask for two people to come and help me with this? Thank you very much for coming to help me. So first of all, I'll explain the technique. This is a coil of copper wire, and what we do is we pass electricity through this coil of copper wire to create a magnetic field underneath. We then place the coil on top of the head over the motor cortex part of the brain. And when we discharge the magnetic field very quickly, it can actually activate the brain cells that are in that part of the brain. So the technique, what it will involve is there'll be a click, which is the machine discharging. And that click is very brief. It'll go for about 1 millisecond. And that's actually the duration of the stimulus. Then what's going to happen, in about 13 milliseconds after the click, you're going to see my arm contract like this, okay? And it's the 13 milliseconds is the time that it takes for messages from my brain, from my motor cortex, to travel down into my muscle and cause my muscle to contract and move my limb. So who would like to hold the coil on top of my head? You would?
I'll just... No responsibility taken.
I'll just turn the machine on.
Very good.
So it needs to be up that way.
You're going to press the button?
Yeah.
No responsibility taken.
Screamer.
Okay, so Antoine, your job's going to be to push this yellow button, and that's actually going to stimulate my brain.
Yeah.
So please wait until I say that I'm ready before you do that. And Chaz, you're actually going to hold this on top of my head, okay?
And you're going to be seated.
Yes, I'm going to be seated.
Just once or a single time?
No, just once, please. Okay, so I'm going to contract my arm. And Antoine, if you want to press that yellow button. Okay, and again. Oh, and again. All right, so the movement was a little one. We'll turn it up, make a much bigger movement.
How do we know that you're not doing that voluntarily?
It's too quick. So I couldn't possibly react in time to that noise clicking. Reaction time is more like 100 milliseconds, whereas my movement's happening 13 milliseconds after the noise. So I turned it up a lot more, and it should make a much bigger movement now. Okay, Antoine. I actually got the coil. Okay, we'll do that one more time. Okay, and again. Okay. So hopefully everyone was able to see that movement. Thank you very much.
Good.
Please thank helpers. Thank you. So as scientists, this technique is incredibly helpful for us because not only does it tell us about how the information travels between the motor cortex and the muscle, but it can also give us some information about how the cells within the motor cortex actually communicate with one another. Now, once we've stimulated the brains of people, we actually need to record a response. And we record the response over the muscle itself, or we record the response being muscle activity. Now, the way that we can record muscle activity is to stick these little electrodes onto the skin surface, just overlying the muscle that we're interested in. So these little devices, we connect them to our equipment and we can listen to muscle activity. Now, we can also listen to the activity of just one nerve cell and the muscle fibres that it connects to. And the way that we can do that is to insert little wires into the muscle that are shown here. These are very, very, very fine wires that we actually insert into the muscle, and then we have people actually perform movements with these little wires that are inside the muscle. And through those wires, we can record the messages that are travelling down one nerve cell and going to the muscle. Okay, I'll just explain what you're going to see here. Up the top is a recording that's going to let you know every time my brain sends a message down through this one nerve cell. So each of these vertical lines represents a message. Now we're going to be able to see what each of those messages looks like in this panel down the bottom here. So the messages that come down this nerve cell are actually called action potentials. And so we can see the shape of the action potentials, or the information, travelling down my nerve cell. Now I'm going to turn the volume on as well so that you'll be able to see and hear my nerve cell communicating with my muscle. Now each one of those little popping noise is a message travelling from my brain down my nerve cell. Down here is the shape of each one of those messages. And it's through these messages that my brain is communicating with my muscle. So I don't know about you, but I think that that's just amazing. The fact that you can record from one nerve cell in a conscious human being while they're performing a movement, I just think is fascinating. And I've been doing this for 10 years now and it still excites me to see it, so. Okay, so scientists can use all these different types of imaging techniques and stimulation and recording techniques during a variety of movements. And on this slide I've included examples of some of the movements that I've used to study how the brain controls the hand. So some of these movements can be formed with commercially available equipment. So over here is a test called the grooved pegboard. Now this test involves picking up a key-shaped peg and putting it into corresponding holes. However, most of the movement tests that our scientists do are actually performed with equipment that we've designed and made ourselves. It doesn't look pretty, but it really does the job. So here in this middle photo is an object that we built to try to investigate how people manipulate objects. we can gain an incredible amount of information from this little device here relating to how much force people are applying, what the effect of gravity is on the object as they're moving it from A to B. And we can also get information about the kinetics or the speed of the movement as well. And over on this picture, this is how we actually measure tremor. So this little device here is an accelerometer, and we attach it with glue onto the fingernail, and we can actually measure very, very small fluctuations in the finger. Well, they're small in healthy people, but they actually might be quite large in people that have a movement disorder. So it's this with this little device that we can measure tremor. Now, scientists can utilise all these different types of techniques and many more to investigate what happens when there's disease or damage to parts of the brain that control movement. Now, damage or disease to parts of the brain that are involved in generating and executing movement can lead to a wide variety of symptoms. Some of the symptoms of movement disorders include tremor, rigidity, which is increased joint stiffness or muscle tone. People can experience what's called tics. They're sudden, repetitive and jerky movements. People can undergo postural instability, so having problems with balance. The movement disorders can affect their walking and also impact on the speed of their movements, so the movement speeds can be quite abnormal. Now, some movement disorders actually have a wide variety of symptoms. For example, Parkinson's disease is characterised by tremor, rigidity, postural instability, walking problems, and abnormal movement speed. Now, I'm going to show you some footage of a patient with Parkinson's disease to try and give you a better appreciation for the types of symptoms that patients experience. So this woman has a pronounced tremor in her hand, so her hand is moving uncontrollably, and that was at rest. But when she moves, the tremor is less apparent, and this is quite a characteristic feature of Parkinson's disease. Now, other types of movement disorders can be characterised by just one or two unique symptoms. For example, a condition called dystonia is characterised by sustained muscle contractions that cause a limb or a body part to go into an awkward position, or and it often involves a twisting as well of the limb. So I'll show you some footage of a patient with dystonia. So this gentleman has quite a pronounced dystonia in his hand. His hand is quite contorted because the muscles in his hand and his forearm are contracting constantly, and they've made his hand go into quite an awkward posture that involves a bit of twisting as well. Now, often movement disorders can be quite difficult to diagnose because the symptoms can overlap with one another. And in some rare cases, a definitive diagnosis may only be possible once a person has passed away. The symptoms of movement disorders can actually have a profound effect not only on the patient, but also on their family. The patients have quite an impaired ability to perform normal activities of daily living that you and I would take for granted. And they can also experience problems with mobility and their social life, and the condition can affect their self-esteem and their cognition. Now, patients with a movement disorder called essential tremor, they actually can have problems particularly with eating. Essential tremor is characterised by a tremor during movement. So when patients are actually trying to eat, they might struggle to put their fork onto the food and then bring the food up to their mouth. And quite often when they're drinking, they'll actually have to leave the cup on the table and actually use a straw to drink so that they don't spill the liquid. Now I'm going to show you some footage of a patient with essential tremor, and hopefully the footage will give you some appreciation for the difficulties that these patients in particular experience every day, but also the types of things and difficulties that they might experience when they're out in public. For example, when they're trying to have a meal at a restaurant. So this gentleman has quite a pronounced tremor while he's trying to hold his arms up, doing a movement. But in a minute, he's going to put his hands down on his legs. And an essential tremor isn't associated with a tremor during rest. But once he begins to move again, the tremor comes back. And this is the patient trying to drink from a bottle. Luckily, the lid is still on. And he'll have problems with his other side as well. So hopefully that footage can help demonstrate how difficult it would be to go to a restaurant and enjoy a meal with your friends or family. Now, although essential tremor isn't well known, it's actually one of the most common movement disorders. Now, this condition affects between 4 and 5% of adults aged over the age of 65. Like I said previously, it's characterised by tremor during movement, but it can also the tremor can also be present during posture. Now, the tremor is quite evident when you ask these patients to try to write or draw. And here's an example of a patient that's tried to write A, B, C, D, E. And here, the patient has been asked to try and draw a spiral. Now, although they've been able to draw the general pattern of the spiral, you can see that it's quite wobbly. And in the writing in particular, there's lots of wobbles with the pen. And this is due to their tremor. Now, the other most common movement disorder is a condition called restless leg syndrome. Now, this condition also isn't very well known, but it affects between 4 and 5% of adults aged over 60. Now, this condition is characterised by an urge to move the legs that's due to uncomfortable or unpleasant feelings that are actually in the legs. Now, the symptoms are much worse when the person's trying to relax and rest, and they're particularly bad when the patient's trying to sleep at night. Now, quite peculiarly, the symptoms can actually be partially or totally relieved by moving. So what happens is these people lie down at night to try to go to sleep, and they get the urge to move their legs. And to relieve the uncomfortable feelings that are associated with that, they actually move. And so because they're moving so much during the night, it has quite a profound effect on their sleep quality, and it can affect all aspects of their life due to poor sleep. Now, in comparison, the most well-known movement disorder is probably Parkinson's disease. And this disorder affects about 1% of adults aged 65 to 74 years. However, the prevalence does increase with age, and it increases to about 3% in individuals that are aged over 85 years. Now, the economic impact of movement disorders to the Australian community and the Australian economy is not known. However, we do have some data for Parkinson's disease. So the annual lifetime costs of caring and treating for an Australian patient with Parkinson's disease is approximately $100,000 per patient. And this is actually equivalent to the cost and care associated with a cancer patient. Now, the overall cost of Parkinson's disease alone to the Australian economy is estimated at $6.3 billion per annum. And much of this expense comes from the cost of treating patients with expensive medications and with expensive operations such as deep brain stimulation. Part of this expense is also due to the fact that people can live with Parkinson's disease for many years. Now, the cause of movement disorders is not known, but it likely involves both a contribution from genetic susceptibility and environmental factors. There's a rare movement disorder called Huntington's disease, and actually 99% of cases of people with Huntington's disease can be accounted for through genetic abnormality. However, only 50% of patients with restless leg syndrome and 50% of patients with essential tremor have a family history of their disease. Now, the influence of genetic factors seems to be a little bit less for Parkinson's disease, because only about 15% of patients have a genetic origin of their disease, and at the remaining 85%, the cause is unknown. Now, there isn't a cure, or scientists haven't been able to identify a cure for movement disorders, but it isn't through lack of trying. Research has focused on five broad themes. Firstly, trying to understand the disease mechanism, which is critical for trying to design cures and develop cures. We have also been trying to develop ways that we can protect brain cells from further damage or disease. Scientists have been working at trying to design better treatments to try and reduce the severity of the symptoms. And we've also been trying to identify individuals that might be predisposed to getting a movement disorder. And lastly, scientists have been trying to develop ways to improve early detection of movement disorders. In the case of Parkinson's disease, the clinical symptoms only become apparent when there's been a very significant amount of damage done to an important part of the brain that's involved in movement. Now, huge resources have been dedicated to particular movement disorders. For example, Parkinson's disease has been studied in 56,000 research studies or experiments, whereas the more common condition, essential tremor, has received less attention, and there's only 2,100 studies. Now, my research interests are trying to improve the early detection of movement disorders and trying to identify ways identifying predisposition to movement disorders, so people that might go on to develop a movement disorder later in life. I've been using a technique called transcranial ultrasound, which is simply ultrasound through the skull. And I've been using this technique to study a part of the brain that is very important for initiating movements. Now, this particular part of the brain is called the substantia nigra, and it resides within the brainstem. Now, MRI isn't really helpful in looking at this brain structure, but it's quite fascinating that the humble ultrasound can actually help us to visualise it. This is an ultrasound image of a person's brainstem. The outer edge of the brainstem is shown encased in the dotted white line, and the arrows show the anatomical site of the substantia nigra. Now, in normal healthy people, it's quite difficult to see the substantia nigra because it appears black on a black brainstem. However, in Parkinson's disease, the substantia nigra appears very bright and quite enlarged. Now, this abnormality is called hyperechogenicity, and it's thought to reflect iron accumulating in this part of the brain. Now, hyperechogenicity is very common in Parkinson's disease patients. Approximately 90% of Parkinson's disease patients have this abnormality. In Parkinson's disease, hyperechogenicity is more pronounced opposite to the more affected body site, and it's correlated with the age of disease onset. The abnormality is quite stable throughout the course of the disease, and it's thought to reflect a predisposing factor for developing Parkinson's disease rather than neuronal degeneration. Now, quite interestingly, this abnormality can be found in some healthy people. Approximately 9% of healthy adults also have substantia nigra hyperechogenicity. The prevalence in healthy people increases with age, and it's also higher in healthy first-degree relatives of Parkinson's disease patients. In healthy first-degree relatives, the incidence of this abnormality is about 45%. Now, in healthy people, this abnormality is actually associated with clinical signs and symptoms that are consistent with preclinical Parkinson's disease. Now, we designed a study to investigate what this abnormality means in healthy people. What we did is we combined the ultrasound of the substantia nigra with the brain stimulation that I demonstrated earlier. Now, what we found is that healthy people that had this abnormal ultrasound image actually have an abnormal feature in their motor cortex as well. So I'll just remind you that the motor cortex is the part of the brain that sends messages to the muscle. Now, the abnormality that we found in the motor cortex was actually similar to the abnormality in the motor cortex that Parkinson's disease patients have. So by doing this study, it helped to increase our understanding of what this substantia nigra abnormality might mean, in that it's actually affecting how other parts of the brain that are involved in movement, it's affecting how they're functioning. Now, we think that the change that we're seeing in the motor cortex in the healthy people might reflect one of two things. It could reflect, early Parkinson's disease, or it could reflect potentially the brain's natural compensatory mechanisms that are trying to overcome the problem that's in the substantia nigra. So in a sense, what it might be is that the change is actually reflecting the brain trying to help itself. Now, to try to tackle this question, we're currently doing a study that we've added two new techniques to the ultrasound and the brain stimulation. We've added magnetic resonance imaging, functional magnetic resonance imaging, to investigate brain activity during movement in healthy individuals that have the abnormality, and also the tracks or highways that are going between brain regions. And in addition, we're also looking for very subtle problems with movement. For example, we're actually measuring tremor in these healthy people to see if they have similar types of tremor problems, although much less severity, as to what Parkinson's disease patients have. Now, our work is also focusing on trying to validate the ultrasound technology as a diagnostic tool for helping to separate Parkinson's disease from other movement disorders that have similar symptoms to Parkinson's disease. So I'll just remind you that Parkinson's disease patients, 90% of people have this hyperechogenic substantia nigra. However, patients with two similar type conditions, progressive supranuclear palsy and multiple system atrophy, they actually have a normal substantia nigra. So we can differentiate Parkinson's disease from these two conditions based on an image of the substantia nigra. Now, it gets a little bit complicated trying to separate Parkinson's disease from these two conditions, corticobasal degeneration and dementia with Lewy bodies, because these two conditions also have the same abnormality that Parkinson's disease patients have. However, we can separate Parkinson's disease from these two conditions by looking at the size of the third ventricle. The third ventricle is a fluid-filled sac within the brain, and in these two conditions, the size of the third ventricle is quite markedly enlarged. So we can separate Parkinson's disease from these two conditions by looking at both the substantia nigra and the third ventricle. We can differentiate between Parkinson's disease and essential tremor, because essential tremor actually has normal ultrasound features. And we can differentiate Parkinson's disease from vascular Parkinsonism by slightly looking at the substantia nigra. It's a little bit trickier in these patients because they have a slightly higher incidence of the substantia nigra abnormality. So it's present in 20% of people compared to 9% in healthy adults. But these patients actually have abnormal blood flow, whereas Parkinson's disease patients don't. So through utilising or looking at various structures of the brain that are involved in movement and involved in some other brain functions as well, we think that the ultrasound is actually can be developed as a very helpful diagnostic tool for clinicians to try to separate Parkinson's disease in particular from conditions that have similar symptoms to that of Parkinson's disease. Now, my other research interest is tremor. Now, we all have an underlying tremor, but most healthy people don't actually notice it. However, you can notice it if you try to hold your hand up close to your face and look at your fingers or your hand. You'll notice that there's actually some very mild or small fluctuations in your finger or your hand position. And that is normal physiological tremor that we all have. Now, I mentioned previously that I use this little device up the top here to measure those very subtle fluctuations in the hand or the finger. And through the data that device gives me, I can actually generate a graph down here that objectively characterises the tremor. So on the y-axis is the amplitude or size of the tremor, so how big it is. And on the x-axis is the frequency of the tremor, which is how many fluctuations per second that the finger moves, or how many tremors per second. Now, this is data from a healthy person, and most of the tremor in this healthy person is happening at a frequency of 10 hertz or 10 fluctuations per second. This is quite normal for a healthy person, and the range for healthy normal tremor is between 8 and 12 hertz. Now, I'm particularly interested in action tremor or tremor during movement, and I've mainly been focusing on measuring tremor in healthy people. We don't actually know yet where tremor comes from in healthy people, which makes it quite difficult to try to understand what's going wrong with tremor in movement disorders. So what I've been doing is I've been looking at tremor while I get volunteers to do a constant muscle contraction here. So what I've asked the subject to do is to hold their contraction at about 20% of maximal. And I actually give them a target, and they have to keep their force on top of that target. So people can actually do that quite well. You can see that there's only very minor fluctuations in the force here. But then what I do is I get people to do fatiguing exercise. And after the fatiguing exercise, there's a dramatic increase in the tremor. And you can see that here when the person has tried to repeat the task. So I've asked them to hold their force at a constant amount, and they haven't been able to do this. There's huge variations and fluctuations in their force, and this is due to a significant tremor that you can, it's very obvious when you're actually looking at it. So what I'm doing is I'm using a fatiguing exercise to try as a model to try and increase the tremor in healthy people to work out which parts of the brain are actually involved in generating the tremor. I'm interested in the parts of the brain that are involved in generating the frequency of the tremor, and also parts of the brain that are involved generating the amplitude or the size of the tremor. So I'd like to finish this evening hopefully I've been able to give you an interesting insight into how the brain controls movement and what can happen when things go wrong in movement disorders. And I'd like to finish by thanking the other researchers who I've do my research with. They're researchers that are based locally, based interstate and overseas as well. I'd also like to thank the support from the Brain Foundation, the National Health and Medical Research Council, and the University of South Australia. They support my work, and without their support, I couldn't do the research. I'd like to sincerely thank the volunteers that help us with our research. They're really the backbone of our work, and we can't make any progress in this area without the generosity and kindness of people that volunteer for our experiments. And I'd like to thank you, the audience, for coming this evening to support the work of local scientists in Adelaide. Thank you.